Okay, so I'd like to introduce the SGA partner panel. So I would like everyone to just say who they are. I guess I can start since I have the mic. I'm chairing the group. My name is Erik Dahlstrom. I'm sure most of you have met me already. So I'm with Opera Software. I've been involved in the working group for quite a long time. I can't even remember how many years, but it's not. Well, I'm not the oldest member anyway of the group.
Getting there.
Okay.
Yeah, all right. So, pass them on.
So I'm Chris Sully. I work for W3. I've been in the group since it started the group, I guess. So I'm the old guy, and they say, why did we do that again? I go, oh, because of this and this and this reason. Or, I can't remember.
Hi, I'm Anthony Grasso. I help represent Canada on the working group. I've been on the community now for about 3.5 years, so it's kind of a newbie. All things considered.
Hi, I'm Robin Burton. I'm a freelance standards consultant and invited expert on the group. I've been on the group since, I don't know, 2002, on and off. And I guess that's about it.
I'm Alex Dunlow from ABRA. I've been on the group since about 2002 as well, on and off.
I'm Doug Shepherds. I also work for W3C. I've been on the group for 4 years, one year as a member of W3C, and then the last 3 years as an employee of W3C. And like Chris, I'm on the team contacts.
I'm John Bach. I represent the team on the group, and I think I am.
I'm
Patrick Dangler, I'm a scribe.
Not anymore.
And I'm in a small startup called Pitch.
Andrew Slid with IQ. I'm one of the series of representatives to the SVG working group.
Can I add that Tom Harris is also a member? Not very active at the moment.
Some of the members like to hide, but we flush them out.
There are four other members in the room as well. They won't admit to it.
Chris, why are you looking around? You're one of them.
It's Scott.
Yeah, it's Scott.
Yeah, so I wanted to just say a few things about what we've been doing the past year. And if you noticed that we released the SVG 1.1 spec in an updated version, that's actually just live. If you browse or Google for SVG 1.1, you'll get the latest spec, hopefully. And that's currently in last call. The last call period ended. We're now going through all the comments we got. So we'll have some work to do in the group meeting just after the conference. Besides trying to finish up the 1.1 spec to make it more clear, we've been working on extending the test suite for 1.1. So I think the latest number of tests was something like close to 500 tests. Perhaps over 100 of those are not reviewed fully yet. But compared to what we had for the previous test suite release, I think that's 100, 115, something like that. So, but it takes a lot of time to do all the review. So that's more or less what we've been doing, I think.
Can you give an idea of the numbers of tests compared to the Jeff Schiller's table?
Yeah, I think his table is using something like 350 tests or something. And the latest number, if I remember correctly, was 490 something. That includes drafts and unreviewed tests. But yeah, I think we can just open the floor for questions. Or I can ask a question. So, besides that, we've of course been discussing other things like trying to move to SG2, are discussing, for example, what to do with X-Linkatra, which is the Fuchs edition. Yeah, no, I can make a mistake as well as my life, because I've been doing the wiki.
Sure, we've been talking about X-Linkatra for about SVG 2. Okay, so currently we use X-Linkatra. Who here doesn't know what I'm talking about? Okay. X-Linkatra. The X-Link namespace. That's what I'm talking about. So we use the X-Link namespace. And this has been a point of consternation for a lot of people, and it's not that hard, people. But okay.
It's clumsy.
How about that? Everyone agrees it's clumsy. Just like Tim. So what we want to do for SVG2 is we want to allow both syntaxes. So if you have href, if you just have say use href rather than xlink href, that would work. And okay, so I'm curious, who do people? Okay, so and the other part of that is if you use the .href property in the DOM, the question is what should that do? And currently we're thinking of saying that sets the href. If you have both xlink href and href on the same attribute, that's where you get into possible conflicts. And we would say that href would have precedence over xlink href.
So that's a typical example of the difference between what the working group does and what developers do. Right? Developers either already understand xlink href and think it's fine, or they trip over it all of the time and they say, oh, this is a pain, now I don't have to type that. Whereas we have to decide what happens if someone uses both, which they're probably not going to do, but we're going to have to define it anyway and decide what the precedence is. So these sorts of issues are not necessarily very visible, but it has to be pinned down what they do, so the implementations all do the same thing.
So what do we
say? 2 minutes. Why is there an issue? Why is there an excellent data level?
Why is there an issue?
Why is there an excellent data level?
It's because historically that was going to be the linking part of XML and everyone was going to use it, and it turned out that wasn't the way. And we basically bit that bullet, we took that bit of pain to buy into the whole XML infrastructure, and it didn't buy us anymore.
Exactly. So the XML infrastructure and namespacing kind of requires that. And there's lots of relaxation of those requirements in HTML. And so part of this is part of
integration.
I don't want to say integration, but smoothing out the relationship and the ease of development for you. So things like this need to come from the community. And this is one of the things that's easy for us to grasp because it's been on the wall for a while. But
well, I guess, and this relates also a little bit to the earlier presentation next door on the changing the past syntax. All these things, I hope the working group takes into account upward or backward compatibility from whichever place they're sitting. Because, exactly as Chris was saying, you can't just change xlink href to href. You've got to support both. And in fact, when IE9 is out there, it will only know one. It will only know xlink href, which means if you're creating content and you want it to run in IE9, you'll use xlink href. And, we all know that's not an overnight change from old versions of IE8 to IE9, and IE9 to IE10, even if 10 did the regular href, it wouldn't. In other words, legacy locks you in a lot longer, I think, than we consider. And this idea of changing the path syntax, great idea. You can't really use it because only the latest version of the browsers will support that new one. And if we want to create content that addresses the whole web, you then choose to use the old syntax. And it takes a very, very long time until you actually adopt a new one, so much so you really got to ask, is it worth it? It's hardly ever worth changing something. It's much better just to add.
Right. I think that's a good distinction. That and this would actually be, we wouldn't change it, right? We wouldn't. We would always support, for backwards compatibility, we would continue to support xlink href in perpetuity.
However, I think it's we're adding a feature of being able to drop the X. I guess my perspective is, if you are too resistant to change, you simply won't go anywhere. I think that we have to be able to add stuff that won't work in older browsers, but we have to be more mindful of making sure that stuff in older in legacy content works on new versions. And I think that one way we can so there's the backwards compatibility thing. There's two ways you have to consider that. And I think that with regards to changing things, it actually becomes a much smoother process if you connect with everybody in the tool chain, and you, from the authoring tools to all the rendering agents and everybody, and say, okay guys, we're going to coordinate and we're all going to move now. And that actually is, and that's what W3C is for, right? It's to coordinate between different vendors in order to move things forward.
Yeah, I'm just saying browser upgrades are, the speed of browser upgrades of the whole base is like an inverse relationship to how large market share is.
Sure.
Larger market share takes a longer time to upgrade the base. And, you know, we can talk about IE6. It's still out there.
Right, but SVG doesn't work in IE6 unless you have a plug. No, I mean, this is a serious issue. I mean, this is a serious
problem. Well, I'm just trying to say it takes so long to upgrade the IE base, and IE9 will be out there for a long time. So.
Yeah, it goes, point being, right? So, should we bring an additive feature? Could it be? Could it have graceful degradation? Right? Could it? And I think it has to be added, right? We've kind of baked in these strange behaviors that we're just going to have to live with, and we've talked about different ways to improve them by not changing them. So.
And this is actually a really good reason why everybody should download IE9 preview, because if there's something in there that you really hate, you should let them know about it. And I think they feel, I mean, this is, you guys feel the same way. If there's something about it,
you're like, it's about 3 months to make changes, and then it's locked in for 10 years.
So this is I mean, this is a real, this should be a real concern for people. I mean, we're not talking about the things that they know that they don't do, right? So okay, animation, whatever, that stuff, maybe that'll be in IE10, we'll see, whatever. But for the features that are there, do make sure that you're downloading this thing, testing it against your application, testing against your content, because that constrains what the working group is going to be able to do to some degree. Going forward, in the other browsers for the next, 10 years.
In terms of legacy content, legacy content is a big issue for those of us who have actually been building stuff in SVG, and changing the spec to kill any of that stuff is something that gets us angry and makes us want to make SVG 5 and take it away from W3C. And
so what?
Well, moving Smile out of, or anything like that. You know,
the SVG working group doesn't. The only thing I think that might be, not dropped exactly, but moved into a module are SVG fonts, and that's because the marketplace moved in the direction of another font format.
Well, that's one of the kinds of concerns that you know, sometimes when I hear about talking about the intersection between what all the browsers do and focusing on that, that's troublesome for those of us who are experimenting with images. But nevertheless, second issue is it seems as though the proper way perhaps to drive specs, I mean, you're still working on 1.1 and 1.2 and 2.0. Maybe breaking things into a multi-layered spec development might make some sort of sense, where one of the specs would be looking very far into the future.
So one of the, very far in the future, it's something to consider. The way we're doing SVG 2, I don't know if, I mean, I've described this before, and I don't know if I've articulated it well, but the way we're doing SVG 2 is we are making a set of modules, individual specifications around features like transforms, around animation, all these other things, individual modules. And then as those get mature, and one of the filters, paint fills, things like this, all the stuff that we're working on with the CSS working group as well, all these things, transforms, filters, animation. So having this modular approach does let us work on specific pieces of functionality that it's easier for people to review, and it's also easier for implementers who want to have an upgrade path from either an SVG Tiny 1.2 or an SVG 1.1 implementation towards SVG 2.0. And so as these modules mature, we're going to what we call park them in candidate recommendation, as candidate recommendation specs. And as all of the modules mature, once we get a better sense of them and we get better feedback from the implementers, we plan on making sure that the specs agree with one another in a really close way. And then from a process point of view, we're going to take them back to, we're going to change them to make sure that they all work together well. Take them back to last call, get comments from the community, and take them back to CR and onto recommendation. So that is a modular approach. As a group, yes. And so that is a modular approach. What about things that are more far looking? Definitely that's a possibility. I mean, if there are suggestions, I know you have some suggestions. If there are suggestions that people have for stuff that might happen further out, yeah, come to us. But one of the main constraints is we've only got so much time. I mean, half the people on this panel rarely attend teleconferences or participate in the lists because they're busy working on implementations. And those of us that are actively working on specifications only have limited amounts of time.
Sure.
So if you are interested in getting in helping us move forward in different directions, part of that would be volunteering time.
Or money.
But most of you have more time than money.
What would happen with a microphone in this?
That's a good question. The browser manufacturers, by and large, didn't like it, partly because it was different, partly because it was seen as a competitor to the regular dot. Actually, the Microdot's got some quite nice features because it is actually an object model. It does actually give you, if something's a color, you can see three floats for the RGB instead of a string, which you can pass to a number, which you can then change that string, and then you send the string back and it gets passed to a number and all this. Right? So I think the fact that the Microdot actually had real live objects in there was better. But so it really hasn't caught up with the browser guys, so it's an ongoing discussion what to do with it.
I mean, it says in the tiny 1.2 spec that for SVG, I think it says SVG 1.24 in the text, but it's not SVG 2.
Yeah.
It's going to be built on the Microdot. So it's going to be, and I mean, we have a lot of content out there that are using Microdot, and that really needs to work in the SVG 2 browsers.
So that's an interesting question.
That's a very interesting question.
Eric, you can go after me, but just in terms of the Microdom, just have to know a little bit of history. One of the complaints that the IE team had last year, or whenever it was, about difficulty of implementing SVG was the SVG DOM. Now, the origin of the Microdom came from Adobe with the experience of implementing the full DOM. So the original concept of a typed interface, like I've got a float on the X value and modify it, was their idea in response to the experience of building the full DOM and being heavily involved in the design. So it came from the experience of the broken full DOM that everybody seems to think needs fixing, right? And it is a very good type interface. Now, the advantage of the micro DOM over the full DOM is exactly what Chris said, the typed interface. But 5 years ago, when there was no V8, there was no Tamarin, there was no Squirrelfish Extreme, the speed difference wasn't visible. Today you're seeing JavaScript that's getting very close to native execution speed. And if you have to stick a string parser in the middle of your extremely fast JavaScript engine versus pulling the float straight out of the DOM into a JavaScript variable, you're going to see a very large performance difference and increase using the Microdot style concept. So really that's a logical thing to pull into 2.0, as well as maybe extend it to cover the functionality that's not in the microdom as such, because there are full features that probably
yeah, I mean, performance aside, I think I actually think I can't come to beta testing. I mean, it really needs to be that test because there's so much content out there using it.
Okay, so I just wanted to comment on some of the things that are in the microdom. It's in a way it's more limited than the full 1.1 DOM, but from implementation experience, it's not hard to support both. The microdom is just returning objects, and it's really simple to have that on top of existing 1.1 DOM interfaces for us at least. As far as content is concerned, I don't know. We haven't seen that much content using microdom so far. So
maybe it's on intranets.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah, if the content's on intranets, we never see it. If it's on mobile devices and it's being shared between that service provider and their subscribers, we don't see it unless we're subscribers, right? So
I mean, I think 99% of that content is on embedded devices and not on the open internet. So it's
right.
I mean, it's not visible, but still, it's a lot of investment.
Sure, but if you don't know about it, and as you say, over time, the 1.2 tiny implementations will need some addressing to as well, so we need to take those into account. We can't just cut that content off.
Yeah, especially as you see authoring tools and not supporting the tiny 1.2 DOM, and more supporting SVG 1.1 and SVG 2.0. It needs to be a neat promotion.
So the SVG working group is only has, we don't have authority over SVG per se, right? We can put something in the spec, but if the implementers say we're not going to do that, then it's actually worse than useless for us to have put energy into something that the implementers will not do. That's a data point. The SVG working group, in order to be empowered to do that, and I said this in another session, in order to empower us to do things in the SVG space, the implementers are not going to listen to this working group. Plain and simple. But, I mean, unless they have a vested interest, they're not going to listen to us. Unless we show them evidence that this is the case, we cannot show them all this content unless you somehow unless you can help us do that, right? So this actually ties, the fact that it's not used on the public web really ties our hands. That said, we need to be able to justify why they should change what they're doing now. That it's just a pragmatic approach. And so if we have the information about that, if we have the data about that, like in terms of raw numbers, where is this happening, the chances of us being able to get something in there are better. Okay, so then all that said, the browser vendors have expressed an interest in improving the DOM. And so that's actually something, not just for SVG, but for HTML as well. And so like people like John Resig have, I've talked to John Resig, I've talked to people at Mozilla, I mean, you guys, we talked about basically the idea of Opera. I mean, we've been talking about for a while, the idea of improving the DOM across the board, not just for SVG. So maybe some aspects of the micro DOM could make it in there.
Yeah, but I mean, improving is one thing, and I think that's very good, but it needs to be improved, but just on breaking that responsibility.
So it depends
on... I don't really think that you need to be motivated. I mean, you really need to be able to motivate something to actually break the responsibility, rather than the other way around.
Okay, so which browsers are you currently using that can't read the microdom syntax?
They can't read it.
Which ones in your tool chain?
I think it's the other way around. They're using the browsers that support it. They'd like to be able to use more.
We aren't hearing that. We're hearing that right now, but we aren't seeing that traffic on the SVG mailing list.
Yeah, it's the first time I hear of anyone using the microdom recently.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It saw a spike in usage 4 years ago or something, and I haven't seen much usage in the past 2 years or so.
Well, I'm a little fussy about something. You said you can't convince the implementers to do things, but this is the implementers' panel.
No, this is the working group panel.
It's the working group panel. Some of us are implementers. I'm not, as you know.
Yeah,
Chris isn't. Eric's not. Oh, no, Eric.
But almost all the implementers are represented in the working group.
You know, even within a browser company,
like, Eric, do you sometimes have difficulty convincing people within Opera that, like, even within, like, we aren't all powerful beings?
Oh, come on.
Well, Chris is. I'm.
I don't write the checks. I push the features up and decide on them. The priorities in SVG is what I kind of wrap my head around. I work with these guys on. I have certain ones in my head, which is, you know, as kind of Ted said, 3 months, HTML and SVG are happening now. Let's nail that. And then there's a finite set of features that we've heard. Some interesting graphical improvements, some format improvements for you know, those things can come in modules. I'm not afraid of them. And then there's the fix. And then there might be like, okay, when we fix, and I think it's fixed. There's added and there's fixed. How do you fix the smart decision number, right? I think a top tier requirement right now is how does this work with HTML? Because it's happening, and we're in a ship, and I want it to be the same. That's keeping me up at night.
Coming to Microdom, maybe when you would shift the SVG support in the Windows mobile phone, you would come to this issue.
When?
Yeah, I'm not in the mobile room.
We saw CSS transitions.
Okay.
We saw CSS transitions in Opera. We saw it in Firefox. We have it in WebKit, and we also try to use it on SVG. But there's still some attributes that are not animatable or not settable even by CSS because of different reasons, like animVal or baseVal. Because of different SVG types, like SVG lengths or something like this, are there any plans to change that, or can we make animate value or any value? Can you find some solutions for SVG lengths or something like that?
Yeah, we can. The smile animation can animate either a property or an attribute, right?
Sure.
CSS animation, since it was aimed at CSS, only talks about animating CSS properties. So there's various ways you could approach that. One would be to make every attribute in CSS a property. Now, if we suggest that every attribute in SVG a CSS property. Now, the CSS working group is very worried about the total size of the property set. They often discuss, for a given proposal, if one adds only one property and one adds four, they'll prefer the one that has one because they don't want to have too many properties. And every property goes on every possible element. So if you do a simple-minded implementation of that, you end up with this big table hanging off every element. Obviously, there are smarter ways to implement that.
If you want to every property, we're not implying to it.
Yes, it will, actually. That is the model in CSS. Every property can be set on every element. It may not affect its rendering, but it may inherit to a child, which that is the issue. And a lot of attributes, I mean, we have some common attributes in SVG, which are on many elements. We have some attributes that only on one element. And convincing a working group to say, okay, we want that to be a property and be on every element, even though it only affects this one thing. You know, like stop color works. So, but another way to change that is to extend the CSS animation thing, so we can say, am I animating a property or am I animating an attribute? Which then gives you complete generality, and that means you can animate other stuff as well, which would be, to my mind, far the better way of doing it.
What about the CSS one?
Yeah, but that's the type of thinking we need to. But we're on the CSS.
Well, the FX task force. FX task force.
But anyway, so your question was a good one, and it still needs to be discussed. But there are benefits and drawbacks to the way this all works.
But it is a known issue that you are working on.
Yes.
Right, but it actually would be really helpful if you bring that to that specific technical issue to the FX task force. You can email www.svg@w3.org or public-fx, and that's actually a better list to respond on CSS plus SVG stuff. You subscribe to the list, send us your issue, and we'll have a discussion about it, because we, you know, there's a lot of different issues, and you've encountered a specific technical issue, and you know, we'd love to have your feedback, but we probably won't solve it correctly until we have the feedback.
that it is actually a problem.
Could you just even now?
I just wanted to ask about the inheritance model that you're using for these CSS properties that apply to all the SVG, just the inheritance model.
So the problem. The problem
is it similar to the property?
No. The properties are divided into inherited ones and non-inherited ones. The inherited ones apply down the entire tree in document order. The non-inherited ones, if you haven't set it explicitly, then you get the initial value, like the default value. But, so that's the way it works. And there's also special keywords called inherit, which even on a non-inherited property means take the value of my parent. So you can sort of do that. So that's the model.
Are they hypercubic in memory? I mean,
that's an implementation issue. If you do the simple-minded thing, then yes, you end up with a massive table on every single element, and your memory goes. But I mean, there are better ways to do that. You can use pointers, and you can do intelligent analysis of where is this and how much do I need to allocate. Basically, you can do some pre-calculation in the same memory, but it makes it slower to render. Or you can just allocate the whole thing and then deallocate it when it doesn't get used. There's various implementation approaches. But the actual model, yes, is that it.
Yeah. This is often where the implementer would say, I'm not looking at this, and they can through their implementation and say, that'll cost too much if it's the longest problem.
Right.
This is something we don't want to do.
Right?
There was a follow up, actually.
Yes, there was a follow up. I still wanted to hear about NMVAL. And I really plan to cut it off because we've still not implemented in WebKit, and the thing is, what's holding us back to do it is I've never got any bug report about it that someone actually wants to use it. I've never seen content which uses NMVAL. So maybe someone can enlighten me where there's an actual real use case, for instance, to script the baseball while the animation is running, and all this stuff which boosts and blasts the SVG DOM a lot and adds a lot of complexity. So what's the deal with it? Are there plans to change it?
That is a good question.
So for us, I mean, the way the DOM is constructed basically puts, you know, what implementation has to do. It's useful if you want to track what's going on in the animation, you want to print values being processed. You can store the pointers to those objects and follow what's going on. You can use that to make a debugger for animations, for example. We haven't seen a lot of use of it, of course, but I think part of the reason for that is Opera is not the biggest implementation. So once Firefox or WebKit adds support for it, or by knowing them, so then probably there will be more use of it, maybe more use cases as well coming from that.
So do people want us to drop NMVAL?
No.
Well, so this is the
way. Show of hands, how many people use NMVAL? Does anyone use NMVAL?
No. So about that. Vincent, you don't know.
There's a general, I think it was said before, once it was in the spec, people will use it or will have used it.
Sometimes you use it, and then you decide it's a bad idea.
So for us, the.
Sorry.
I mean, the base value has to be there, right? Because, I mean, and Smile's got this nice model where you've got the base value, and then you've got the stack of animations, and you can have, while those animations are running, you can still change the base value through script and it will still give a different result, so that's good. So it was thought obvious that maybe you want to get the value at the top of the stack, because the implementation has to calculate it anyway, and what we didn't want was people have to do in script a parallel implementation if they wanted that value. Having said which, grabbing that value, doing something with it, and shoving it back in the bottom again isn't that useful. And the other thing I would say is that the DOM is an API, not a memory model. In other words, you can be lazy there and not calculate it, not store it. And if someone asks for it, well, you probably have access to that value, so you can give them the answer back. Right? You don't have to store it as a big tree. You don't have to allocate on every element just in case.
But one thing is that NMVAL is a bit of
my mind, at least red herring. I mean, the problem here is not so much with the DOM itself. As you said, it's just an API. We can construct any value on the fly. We had a lot with a lot of these DOM because we need to construct these objects that are returned as typed interfaces, as interfaces. That's fine. That it takes a little bit of time to implement it, but it's totally doable, and we've done quite a bit of it already. The problem here is a bigger problem, is what you mentioned before. We have a different animation model between HTML and SVG. That is actually a much bigger issue to tackle. Maybe as a result of tackling that issue, we find that AnimVal should be used in HTML and in SVG. That's fine. That actually might provide a lot of value. Or we find that it's not the case and that it shouldn't exist at all. But the real problem here is to have one single model, or at least a model that scales, if not one, a model that scales between SVG and HTML, so that the developer doesn't have to learn two models, the implementer doesn't have to implement two incompatible models, and we don't have a seam at the transition, so we can mix SVG and HTML even more than we're attempting today. I think that's the biggest problem to tackle first, and then the object model.
Right, and I think that we need to look. I mean, this is one of the intents of the joint CSS SVG working group, task force, rather, is to look at animation, reconcile the models, come up with a consistent model, and actually to provide better script interfaces to that animation, because there's oftentimes limitations to what you can do with declarative animation, and you might want to pass it off to script. Or vice versa. There's use cases for both. So having sort of a really good API for that as well would be a good thing. And we want people to give us feedback on how we should build this.
My recollection serves me.
Right. The specification says today that if you change a value in an animation element, the behavior is undefined, meaning it's up to the implementations to define what that is. So don't do that.
This guy had a question as well.
It was just a follow up about what you said about CSS and SVG and positioning and so on.
Sorry to stick to that, but I don't quite understand why there is, after so many years, a kind of two specifications for animation that tend to collide, and I don't really understand also why time representation is inside CSS. I don't know, style, time, it's not really the same. Smile was imported from the Smile language in SVG, and either it's supposed to stay in the SVG or be in another file to specify what happens at what time. And what is going to happen with this animate tag, like David Bailey was saying, if the CSS animation module I don't know how you say that in English, has the leg up?
Yes,
exactly.
So where this came from was that Smile had it originally. SVG imported it, basically with no change. It worked moderately well. There were some things that were more aimed at Smile presentation. So Smile didn't have very much in terms of the layout, but it had a very complex time model. Essentially, it was a bit researchy, and it did a lot for the time, almost nothing for layout, and it was slideshow type stuff, that sort of thing. So that was okay. We could use it fairly well for SVG. Now, in SVG, you're dealing at a presentational level that's fairly low. We did try to separate out what we call the content. The content for us, though, was really geometry. Right? So some people would say the whole thing is presentational, but we had the attributes, and we could animate attributes, we could animate CSS, that came from Smile, so that was fine. But with HTML, it's much more common. I mean, if you've got 100 paragraphs, the chances are you want to style them all the same. If you've got 100 paths, it's incredibly unlikely you want to style them all the same, right? So there are different use cases, and it's much more common in HTML to have the style out on a separate style sheet so you can restyle, so you can reskin, that sort of thing. So when people wanted to add animation, it was natural for them to look at a style sheet like a model. Now there were proposals, timesheets was a proposal to have a totally separate mechanism that was out there that let you animate. And so it just did animation. But that required getting traction for the whole idea, and it just didn't really go anywhere. So Apple wanted to do these sorts of things in HTML, and Dean Jackson, who had been on the SVG working group and then went to work for Apple, used that as a model to change a few things that he found a problem or he wanted to do things differently, and that's where that came from. So that's why there's probably more similarity than difference, I would say. He's definitely used the Smile Timing model, but thrown away parts that weren't really that relevant for doing fancy stuff on an iPhone. And there is interest now in harmonizing those two, but that's why it's harmonizable at all, because they come from a common source and we can bring them back together again.
And it's part of the rationale that I've heard from WebKit, or specifically Apple guys, is that the people who they were aiming that at, the authors that they were aiming at, were people who were already familiar with CSS. And that, as silly as it sounds, a syntactic difference to those people would be challenging. The authoring tools that these people were using, which they anticipated having, you know, so CSS was just, that format was more familiar to the audience that they were aiming at, and so they put it in CSS. So,
the development patterns come up for a lot, right?
Yeah.
Then this is, I think, what we talked about, XML namespaces in terms of HTML. But the key scenario you brought up and resonated with everybody that I have talked to that's used it is when they integrated SVG in their HTML, they put an href there, and nothing happened.
Right.
And it's just like it was a non-starter. This language doesn't work. And it just goes back to, okay, well, SVG is styleable with CSS, but transitions don't work, you know? Yeah, so animations are rich with time. It's a little weird, I agree, but it's a language that they get. That's just what it's
honestly, it's just a matter of syntax. We're talking about we can reconcile them and have the same functionality in both pointy bracket syntax and selector and curly brackets. And who cares, right? We're just trying to make it as easy as possible. And
as long as the model,
as long as the underlying model is the same, so that the implementers don't have two conflicting models in their browsers, which frankly they wouldn't do. Right? They wouldn't want to have these two different models that have to maintain completely separately. And I wouldn't want to code to it. And also, what happens when I do something using Smile, and one animation using Smile, and another animation is using CSS transforms, or CSS animations, and we haven't said how they work together, it would just be a nightmare. So, absolutely, reconciling the models is the way to go. And we'd love to have somebody from WebKit actively working with the working group to do this.
I would have a follow-up on the uninval issue. So as I understand, it's an attribute, so it's calculated all the time whether it's used or not. But it's not a message, it's an attribute.
It may or may not, like Chris said, it may or may not actually be. Yeah, you can evaluate it just in time.
Okay. So it's no difference whether it's a method or an attribute for implementation.
That's an implementation. I mean, it's such implementations. I don't think that most of them would constantly calculate it. No.
So
next
question. I would have. Do you have a follow-up on the same issue?
Yeah, yes.
Because I have questions on text.
Okay, well, let's go over here first, and then we'll go back to the
chat. Just a follow-up on the maybe the process to get to reconciliation of the models. One thing that we can start small. We can call before we walk, and then run. That works pretty well, and I think if there was reconciliation, say, just on the transition part, CSS has these two parts of transitions and animations. Transitions are much simpler, the time model is super simple, but they're extremely useful because they will allow you to do a ton of very simple visual effects that developers want to do, and today you need to have some JavaScript or something. If we just had reconciliation on that to start with, I think it gives us a way to you know, to progress and kind of altogether kind of move forward. There's a huge value in locking something down and then getting that model, you know, done, reconciled between HTML and SVG, and then moving to the next step. And by the way, before, just one more thing, before transitions, actually reconciling transforms would be great as well.
Right.
And so that's why it's simple.
So if you look at the FX Task Force Charter, and I can point you to it, we actually have a bulleted list of things we want, that we have goals, and they have a priority right beside them, and that is exactly priority. Transforms, high priority. Transitions, high priority. Animation, because it's a bigger problem, is, I think, medium or low priority. I think it's a medium priority. So we have high priority, low priority, medium priority. Part of the problem is that both the CSS and SVG working groups have been busy with other stuff, and so we haven't been as active as we would like in doing this stuff. But now that SVG 1.1 is mostly in the can, this is something we're definitely going to be looking at like right away. Transitions is a higher priority, much higher priority.
So I'm guessing,
again, text.
So in SVG 1.2 tiny, there's text area, and in 2.0 there's also flow text. In the draft also. And I think there's a real need for both, and also editable text. But as I understand the current situation, there's no work on this, so is that wrong? So do we have to rely on foreign object and HTML?
So what's your scenario? Is it just that you want flow-based text, and you also said input? The content editable. Content editable. So these concepts are HTML. This goes back to my sort of, is HTML a foreign element to SVG, or is SVG just part of HTML and we need to figure out how they flow along?
Yeah, because one idea is just take a paragraph tag and throw it in the middle of SVG and you got yourself some flow text.
Okay, yeah. Can I just have that off and say, please?
Yeah. It's something like that.
One of the things about the working group is that the number one demanded feature from the public to the SVG working group for a number of years was flow text, right? And that was, I don't know, 6-7 years ago at least now. And there were plenty of people completely against it, including myself, but we spent a good 2 solid years doing it. And we came up with really good proposals, including flow inside up polygons. We dealt with BIDi in, you know, self-intersecting polygons, all sorts of stuff. The algorithms were all spelled out, and basically all that flow text was killed by certain CSS people that didn't think it was a good idea and didn't have a place in SVG. And so, yes, the HTML paragraph is all well and good, but what you want to do is you want to get a flowchart, shove down a diamond, and flow the text in that diamond, and how do you do that in HTML?
Or editable text on path would also be an example.
Editable text on path, anything like that. So there are serious use cases in real-world applications, like, you know, a paint diagram, for example. Right? Like you want to put the text in the box and you want to center it vertically, horizontally, and it's not square. And these are the use cases that we addressed. And Tiny 1.2 lacks because it doesn't have the arbitrary polygons, but the solutions have already been built, have already been specced and prototyped by Adobe back in 2002 or 2003. So that work shouldn't die, and if we are to bring in flow text in SVG 2.0, we really need to address the use cases that go beyond what you can do in HTML, because who cares if that's just a box, right?
Maybe So
text is something, and then I sort of wrinkle my brain, it's like, oh, Chris doesn't like that. No, Chris has a comment that if you're using a box model, you have this set of negative boxes, and you always know the size of your outermost containing block, and so on and so forth. And if you're using an SVG layout model, then you have a coordinate system, and you can slap stuff anywhere you want. So what happens if you plot a paragraph right down in the middle of some SVG, and use a CSS box model? It says, how big is my containing block? And the answer is, we don't know.
I would argue that SVG always knows, because you could drop the P element inside the circle. Your circle has a center and a radius, and I actually know the containing area inside the diamond, inside the polygon. There's a little computation there, but you just save and actually even the irregular boundaries. I mean, let a key, the let a paragraph element be dropped inside a packet. And when you tell me what it's supposed to do, you know,
right,
it's exactly what you figure out the flow, but just use the key. And say,
that's got to happen. You should actually answer the question, because the point is, no, you can't just do it, you need to define what it's using for its layout, and you've just done that.
So you can pay that, right?
Exactly.
So, can I make a comment there, yeah. Just quickly? I totally agree with you in that the early proposers actually did say something very similar to that, just drop a P. The primary problem... I know that's powerful, but the problem we found...
Someone's going to buy unordered lists, and they're going to want this item, and they're going to want everything.
Okay.
So just basically say all HTML dumped inside, oh, it works.
That's well and good, but the problem, the reason that the SVG group did not adopt that as a solution is the CSS box model with the padding borders, and if you want a border on the inside, right, the padding to be the correct distance, it doesn't work with a rectangular box, right? So reconciling that, non-rectangular, right? So we were trying to reconcile those two things, and the simplest thing was to just say, okay, we will say just layout within the polygon.
Again, this is an area where you start simple and say, we'll define a rectangle inside the circle and we'll wrap to that. That's the process.
But that is the essential problem. It's easy to say right here that resolves the issue. But to be able to move forward, you have to reconcile the models first. As you said previously about the animation, you must reconcile the models first, then you can define the syntax. It's easy to say, put the P there, that's syntax. That doesn't help you. It's the model that needs to be defined first.
Agree, but let's not invent another full text model.
Yes.
That has no chance. And so we want to put HTML, I think, in SVG. If you want tables, if you want, you know, lists and all that stuff in SVG, which is a totally fair thing to want, let's do it via HTML. And then we can define the boundary between HTML and SVG. What exactly should happen in terms of wrapping? You know, do we do type wrapping? Do we do square wrapping, rectangular wrapping at first, and then type wrapping later? Whatever. That can be defined. Let's not invent another flow model that would be specific to SVG and different from HTML, even in certain ways.
I agree, but I want to add also one point, is that when we unify these two models, the coordinate system and the flow model, we have to do it also the other way around to enable the, what was in, I think, one of your slides, with a circle in between, in the middle of a paragraph, without an SVG view box, without... So we should... I mean, this is a reverse problem, right? And when we design this unified, sort of unified model or reconciled model, we have to take into account both ways.
So actually, somebody recently asked me on one of the SVG IRC channels, hey, how do you do flow text in SVG? I said you couldn't. I worked up a demo for him on how you can do it using T-stands manually. Pain in the butt. We all have tried that. It's terrible, but it works. And how you can do it by doing foreign content. So I had side by side foreign content, HTML, paragraph, and then the SVG model, just to give him both comparisons. I'm actually writing a blog post on it. So how do you do it? Anyway, and the thing I found was that every implementation worked. They all did. They all laid it out, but there were very dramatic differences in the HTML part. The SVG part was obviously all the same, but the HTML. So I think it's a really interesting idea. I think that. And the reason it didn't work cross-browser is because there isn't a specification that says, what do you do in the circumstance? And that is definitely something the SVG working group is absolutely interested in working on.
I disagree with what you're saying.
Wait, you disagree that it got completely different results in every browser?
No.
I disagree with when you're saying that we don't have flow text in SVG. We have it in SVG Tiny 1.2. And then we would get the same results. We would have different, and we have different results. For example, if we compare the flow text in Opera and in GPAD, there's a different result. I'm not sure. Because we don't do word wrapping in the same way, we don't do...
The same actually is the case in CSS. You cannot get word-for-word, pixel-perfect matching between browsers.
And that's not part of the spec, frankly.
It's not part of the CSS spec.
And actually, so the XSLFO people are also interested in this problem. And I've heard from some people, so I hear from implementers, we do not want to have pixel perfect representations across browsers. So we're not interested.
We can. The underlying systems have different font technologies, different rendering engines,
right.
Different anti-aliasing algorithms.
No. Designers really want that. I'm just saying that is a data point that designers do want that. So if there's a way to get as close as possible,
I think Bond's cross platform helps, and that's where it's
because
it's so important for the HTML community to have a common linkable font format. So basically, Mac and PC can have the same fonts, and that's just hugely important.
I wanted to hear from Todd. Because you guys were really interested. That was one of your bullet points, right? The flow text. Well, actually, the point was we've implemented flow text all kinds of them, and it's a problem because it's not in the same space. And it's not converted automatically into the SVG namespace. You have the key spans.
Right.
And so if you save browsers, and someone's got to go in there at some point and undo all that. Unless you've got a
text word. Pretty much every drawing journey, Caracol, Adobe Illustrator, they have the sort of text where you pin it down and you start going. And then they have the thing where you drag a rectangle and you start typing inside it and it drafts a single paragraph. And pretty much every drawing tool I've used has those two modes of putting in text.
Visio has this really sweet where it wraps it in shape.
We can wrap it into shape. We can do the rectangle.
Right.
And then if you want to wrap it into shape, you have to do it in two steps. So some people are going to say, if we do this, right, some people are going to say, okay, well, I don't want to use SVG. They're going to say, why can't we do this in CSS? Why can't we define this? These are all questions we're going to have to consider. So there has to be a really coherent model or how do you use for it? I think the answer actually is too bad, suck it up, declare an SVG element, learn how to do it, don't put the syntax in CSS. But these are all questions that we're going to have to answer.
I'm sorry, Evan. Unrelated question.
Change the subject.
Yes. You were talking about modules a little bit earlier for SVG2. Is there... And of course, there was SVG 1.1 and SVG 1.2 Tiny. So, is there already an idea of having one or more profiles for SVG2? And also, no.
Well, we really don't want to have more profiles. I mean, 1.1 had three profiles, right? It had Tiny and Basic and Full. By the time we were finishing off Tiny, people were saying, can we just have gradients, or can we just have this, and whatever, and the big difference was that Basic had a DOM and Tiny didn't, right? 1.2, we did a Tiny, which, the base level was animated and had a DOM, whereas we made a small DOM, so that was fine, so we were down to two profiles. But then we never finished off 1.2 full, because there was all sorts of arguments happening, other things to do, we needed to beef up 1.1 and make it more descriptive and so on, so really, for 2.0, I'm looking at the profile, really.
Yes.
And effectively, the profile will be shown by what modules get adopted and we take that Venn diagram and we pop down the middle and say, okay, this is what's got traction now. The other things might have traction later, but this is what we've got now. This is a 2.0 profile.
Yes.
We always make 2.1, 2.2,
2.0.
I would
like to disagree slightly on what you said. You're saying that
it wasn't that there were lots of arguments. I don't think that's the main reason to go for 2.0. I think the main reason to go for 2.0 is there's lots of traction. There's lots of things happening. The thing we saw in the first keynote is the fact that there are a lot of people doing things and they're doing them in a unified way, and we're finding new arguments, and therefore we're on a new generation where we actually harmonize with HTML and CSS.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that's essential.
Yeah.
And because of that, you have to skip.
But I think even with the new version, the fact that we had all this discussion about should we have a flow layout or something, and some people say just use HTML and that's it. And for instance, in my experience, It's very easy, for instance, if you want to work on the web app and you do it in HTML and you can have some icons in SVG, and it's great because it scales and it has lots of interesting features. And then I want to do an application that works in a pure SVG tiny context. And in that case, I don't have all my fancy, but at least easy layout. So now I have to put my button exactly at this point and not dump it in a div or something. So there are clearly different use cases, different scenarios. There's also the case that I think SVG Tiny was designed for low capability devices, and so it doesn't have clipping, it doesn't have masking. But isn't there also a case that you might want to implement a part of SVG, and the problem that you don't want to do everything is not because your device is low power, is also because you don't have that much manpower, so you say, I'm not going to do animation, but I still want to do SVG and clipping and masking because my underlying graphic engine allows me to implement a lot of SVG very easily, but then there's another a lot of things that are hard to do.
Yeah, the problem with that is that each implementer or each little use case has their own thing. So when we were doing 1.1, for example, BitFlash suddenly did this thing with TI, and they were using this low-end processor, but it had a DSP on it, and they suddenly went, we can do all the filters, every single one of them, they're hardware accelerated, as fast as anything, but we don't want these other features because they're hard for us. So the problem is, once you split it down, you end up splitting it 20 different ways, because, you know, and we had an implementer, Intersys, they were doing industrial automation stuff, so they had sort of Windows CE-based panels for automation, and they didn't care about filters, they would never, ever use filters. You know, they wanted polygons and fills and stuff like that, and those sorts of things. So they wanted DOM animations because they could interact and, you know, do toggle switches on and off, network rebooting, all that sort of stuff. So depending on what they were doing, different people wanted different things. And as soon as you get into profiles, it's very hard to stop them. You know, you end up with a technical illustration profile and a graphic arts profile,
and then the content doesn't work. I mean, then you get a schism,
in the content.
Isn't that what we said, that let's modularize it and let the industry decide which ones they want to pick?
So let's make sure that the spec allows easily for both implementers and content developers to know on the platform that they're using which modules are implemented and which are not.
Well, yeah.
Can I just the early history of trying to get SVG into the three profiles in the 1.1 time frame? You know, we learned from the industry, right? You know, there were so many meetings about chopping up vertically, horizontally, modules on the side, you know, base, you know, tiny, the optional tiny modules, I mean, all these diagrams on the board. At the end of the day, we built these three profiles, right, which happened in a fairly quick time frame, really, from 1.0. The next lesson, which was 1.2 tiny, it took 7 years. Now, that's a lesson to us. We, you know, in the press, it's like the glacial pace of standardization. It's like, well, yeah, 7 years from sub 1.2 tiny to recommendation status is glacial, and it's because we get denial of service attacks from people that don't like what we're doing and trying to get all the features in that all the implementers want. And learning from that, with 2.0, we go, well, okay, we'll have a core, we'll make the core the common set that everyone really wants. The nice features that other people think they want, if they're in separate modules, then the market will shake it out. Implementers will build it, they'll use the modules, and if that happens, then there may be a 2.1, which is 2.0 core with this module and that module. But rather than profile it, to get it fast through W3C, split off the individual features into modules, and that's kind of the approach.
I think the modular approach is the way you have to go, and not sort of as a working group try to solve the problem. But yet, to the last questioner and the gentleman over here, it feels like there is a real crossroads here. And maybe it's best described as SVG for the sort of, well, public web, where the characteristics are, could be any one of about a billion people that browse the web in over 100 languages all around the world. Or I'm using SVG to build maybe an industrial panel, or I'd love to hear from our colleague at Canon there, that you know your device, you know your audience, you don't really care if the SVG you're authoring ever runs in IE9, because IE9 is not running on your camera or copier or in other embedded device. So then it doesn't matter if IE doesn't support some feature that you were using. But at the same time, the browser vendors have the opportunity to really take SVG up a notch, because we're building on very powerful text engines and rendering engines and layout engines. And I mean, SVG could get to be such a complicated spec if you let it. But there's no way it could be, that there's no way it could be implemented in an embedded device realistically. I mean, maybe you just go grab the WebKit source and do it. No. Well, I mean, it's always possible, but it may be unneeded. I mean, unless you need full HTML flow layout, maybe on an embedded device, maybe it's not needed. But that just, there seems to be at least that level of cross-references, for what it's worth.
Yeah, I just want to add one point to what was said before. Maybe a slight disagreement from my side. I understand that I agreed at the time with this modular stack. But modules are, as you explained, Alex, modules are there to improve the standardization process, right? Profiles are there to improve interoperability, because you make sure that, yeah, if you have too many profiles, it's bad for interoperability.
29%.
Yeah. If you have too many profiles, it's bad for interoperability. But sometimes, if you have only one profile, it's also bad, because if the spec is too big, no one will implement everything. Cutting stuff, you cannot. You cannot. What's in there, it's there. Profiling is the way you cut things. So maybe what I want to say is that it's not because we have designed the spec using modules to speed up the standardization process that we should stick to that in terms of profile. We could have like two profiles across modules, not profiles per module, and multiply and would be a mess. But having like the tiny profile for our embedded devices and the full profile for the for PC world, I think it's, that would be my suggestion.
I have one comment
to make.
I just want to make one comment to that. That was exactly what was said in 2003, I think it was, at the Schemasoft meeting. We had exactly that on the board with the profiles and the modules on the side, and we just couldn't get it to work. And these are the problems that the working group faces every day, trying to work out how to slice and dice.
Just really quick follow-up on that. I see one possible way of profiling usefully, and that is to actually categorize, not to work on an individual profile, like a separate profile. Like SVG Tiny 1.2 was a profile of SVG, and we spent a huge amount of time working on it. But within the same spec, marking out certain features as marking out, that would be a more efficient from a standards point of view, saying, okay, yes, it will. From a standards point of view, yes, it will.
Because you need to test option just to...
No. The profile, never mind.
Yeah, it's still related. So when they call it profiles, or when they call it modules,
two different, completely different concepts.
I understand that they're being proposed as two completely different concepts, but if you have a set of subset of modules that actually get implemented by subgroup, then I mean that's de facto
profile.
That's right.
That's
right. So
if a customer drives profile, the browser vendor delivers that profile, it becomes a profile class. That goes back to the interoperable set that was talked about at the beginning.
Sure.
At the point of time where we looked at the set that we were looking at, that was the profile.
Yep.
Those were the features we selected. And that may shift over time. I mean, we have to track that. But there could be modules that we never touch. But it's in the spec.
Right. And so it makes sense, yes, that you get this interoperable subset. This is the profile that people implement. But really, I guess the real question is how, when you approach modules this time for SVG 2.0, how are you deciding what's a module and what's, like, where to draw the lines between modules? As Chris pointed out, for some vendors, it might turn out that all of a sudden this feature is easy for us, that feature is not for us. Those features that are easy or hard don't necessarily follow along the lines of what's in a module or not a module.
Okay.
So
you
how do you
draw specifically with features as sub-features within a module, not which modules get?
Right, so how do you decide what's a module and which features are a module? If somebody implements all the features of a module except for one, then how do they implement that module? And can we still take it?
That's through last call and CR. So the process is that exist today. Last call is when you guys say, this is the thing, this is going to go to the implementers. The implementers have already started, and they're going to come back with their feedback and say, these we don't want. These we want. And before that, the implementers want to hear in last call that you, this is a very important feature for me as a developer, a user of this technology, and I want you to implement this. Or it doesn't make sense this way, the model should be slightly different, because this is the way I think as a developer.
I guess I'm not clear on how closely that matches up to the reality that we've seen with implementation of SVG over time. I mean, like when Firefox first implemented SVG, and it was like, these pieces we have, these pieces we don't. There's features there for module detection, but they don't actually...
That's sort of an accident of history, in a way, because not just the browser vendors were not implementing SVG at all.
Right, yeah,
we had a few small implementers, and those implementers, well, not small, like Adobe.
Yeah, Adobe, correct.
So we had, okay, but not the browsers, right? And there weren't that many browsers back then either, right? The set of implementers at the time all agreed to those features, and they all implemented them. And then the market shifted. Adobe decided to, not use their SVG expertise anymore, and so it shifted to the browser vendors. And so now we have a different set of implementers that have say, and so it shifted over time. One set of the initial set of implementers were implementing all those features, or most of them. And then another set of implementers came on and said, whoa, this isn't, we didn't want to sign up for, fonts. We don't want to do SVG fonts. So the market has shifted over who the people making the spec are, who the implementers are. So that's just in a sense, an accident of history.
Yeah, I guess that brings up points to the view of the specification as being something that's impartial, separate from reality versus this iterative process that does involve implementers, it does require implementation. So
right.
I think it's like you pointed out earlier, you need implementers in order to give credence to the value to what these implementers.
Okay. Yeah, and Rob, I think you're right in saying that, which is why the word move in recent times is actually treated fairly cautiously. And by that I say, we're putting out specs now as modules to see what the take-up is like. And then once we know what the take-up is like, or once we know what's been used, what's been developed, then we can run a bit of what's out there. So, and as Alex said, we've learned from the past. So.
And also I want to point out that we are trying actively to get the different implementers onto the table. I mean, tough, right? We've been trying to get Inkscape involved, as an authoring tool, involved in the SVG working group for years, and it's only when Tav stepped up and said, yes, I will actively do this, that we actually are getting good feedback and have a good back and forth with the community, right? It's really important to have the implementers on board. And that's why we want WebKit. Oh, I'm talking to you guys.
Can we take one more question, and then...
I don't know if I want the last question. The thing that came to mind is that as you split a working group into little subgroups, the likelihood that the bigger companies dominate those subgroups increases because they have more staff to devote to such a thing, in theory.
I don't understand the question.
We're not splitting the group up, we're splitting the spec up, but each spec has this.
Yeah.
Okay, there'll be people more interested in one than another, that's true, but in general, each module will be discussed by the entire group. We're not going to form like working groups of one or two people.
Yeah.
Even in a big group, that happens. If you're not interested in a specific feature, you drop out of the discussion and you wait till you are.
Yeah.
If you're interested, you make sure you're there. And that, I think, is a great advantage to the way that W3C works, is it's one voice for each company.
And so, and it's based on, at least in the SVG working group, very much on proposal. Is your proposal, does it have merit that you often win the argument?
One of the problems, though, with having implementers so closely involved with spec development is that feasibility is such an impediment. Reality is interfering with dreams.
Or you could just say you're not putting things in the spec that will never get implemented.
And marketability.
Yeah, but there are both sides to thinking of the future. There's thinking ahead, and there's thinking about what's practical, and there's figuring out how to get from one to the other. For example, in the example of a layout model, you will at some point in time have to change it into something that is non-rectilinear. That will happen at some point in time, because cartographic data is going to be poured into polygonal tessellations of the plane.
We hear you, David, but the one thing is that the working group is not a research and development outfit. Right? We set standards for this to the community, and we try and standardize an interoperable set for all implementers. We don't go in the pie-in-the-sky things that this might be cool as much as it may be great.
Maybe that's what the WSBG needs to think tank inside it.
But
it
you are
funded.
This SVG Open is that. What cool ideas come out of that?
However, I will say, and this is one thing I've seen increasingly in the last few years, is that sometimes we'll see proposals that are deeply worked out, they've gone through the use cases, they figure out what they want to do, and they'll include an implementation, however slow it may be, you know, something in JavaScript or whatever, so that you can actually try it out. And that helps demonstrate the feasibility, and that means that you're much more likely to get traction from the other implementers. And it also means that the group isn't swayed by three implementers who have the veto and everyone else who says, please, sir, may I? You know, so someone that really cares can actually code something up like you did for the parameter spec, right? You're not an implementer per se, you're a big implementation, but you coded that up and you showed that it was tractable, feasible.
And that's why I went blank. It's because this is something that I'm actually practicing as, you know, a working group member. I'm not an implementer. I have very little say in what implementations do, unless I can influence them in some way. And that's exactly how I've influenced them. But also, that's one of the ways we're trying to reach out to communities, by making the primers. I don't know if you've seen that with most of our new specs. We're making primers that show exactly what sort of use cases, at least some of the use cases that we had in mind when we designed this, right, this feature, like parameters. And I got really good feedback on parameters where other stuff that the SVG working group had put out did not get very good feedback. It didn't get any feedback, right? We weren't getting feedback. By putting out stuff in primers, we're trying to make it more accessible to the people who we expect to use it. And we want your feedback on whether this is the right way of doing this thing. So if you treat it similarly in terms of feeding back to us, I mean, that's how we can have a dynamic community that actually works on things.
I just want to feed into that, which is the question I was going to ask if I would have started this discussion. Can you list the kinds of capabilities, of the exposure that the SVG working group is? What are the touch points to the community so that they know that?
So, I think we should close.
Start at the W3C SVG 4.0 website.
That the SVG working group, we revamped the SVG working group website to try to make it easier for you to give us this feedback and to find out what we're doing. We're tweeting, we're trying to get the word out. So get into that feedback.
So.